Welcome back. You're still watching Urban Today. Now join the conversation on social media and, you know, be part of what we are looking at. Joining me now is Hajat Medina Naham. She is the Director of Finance and Administration, of course, at Plot 10, that is the NRM Secretariat, and of course for the NRM. A very good morning and welcome to the show.
Good morning and thanks for the invite.
Right. You have been so far, this is about the third month?
Yes,
on
I'm
the
just
job.
Starting the third month.
Congratulations and
thank
well
you.
Done.
Thank you so much.
How is that going?
I'm really, of course, I've come in a season
of
heightened political activity and it's there's a lot of pressure, but we are managing and of course we always work as a team. Mm-hmm. And but I'm enjoying the job.
You're enjoying?
Yes.
Of course you're enjoying this finance and administration. So there's money. You're dealing with money. So it's
not necessarily money, there's administration and much of it really is not about money. Mm. You know, when people say NRM, they think about money first. Not really. We have so many other things that go on besides that. Yes.
Like what?
Mobilization. Mm-hmm. We do a lot of mobilization activities, really, which do not involve money. As you can see right now, we are the leading political party. If you look at our recent performance in SIGs, the performance in the number of people, of course, the number of contenders that are coming up in the general elections, about 80% already are from the NRM.
Yes.
And that tells you that we have much more that is going on. And
That's interesting. Maybe if I could remind us, is that Hajat Medina, you know, took over from Haji Galiwango, who was the director then. But for now, she is here and she is in a season that is very hot. Before we can go into, of course, the plans you have for your new position, how is the situation like right now? People are talking about taxpayers' money being used during these elections. How do you differentiate between taxpayers' money and the NRM money? Because we understand, of course, the NRM is rich as the money.
So when people talk about taxpayers' money, I don't exactly get what they mean. Because we have three key sources of funding. One of which
at the NRM?
Yes. One of which is through government. You are aware government funds political parties, and political parties get about 10 billion in a year, and given the fact that we have the numerical strength of the NRM, gives us, of course, a bigger portion of that budget. We also get donations.
Still, that is taxpayers' money.
No. We get donations from members, because when people say taxpayers' money, I know what exactly they are driving at. It's different. Our own members mobilize and they fund the party activities. We also have expression of interest, like recently we have we've nominated our candidates for different elective positions and they were charged a certain fee.
Yes.
So that was also key and it is one of the resources that's going to push us through this season. Mm. But also there's a fourth one, mainly from our members of parliament, they also do contribute a small fee.
Okay.
So basically that, really.
So you don't tamper with taxpayers' money at all?
When you say taxpayers' money, maybe you have to explain exactly what you mean.
You see, we're in an elective period, and people out there definitely, when they see the NRM, you know, actively, you know, supporting their own and funding their own campaigns and everything, they do not understand that it is coming from you as the NRM. It is coming from the taxpayers who pay taxes. So perhaps because you have access to the country's state coffers, you have access to our money, so you spend our money.
How do we have access
to the state coffers?
You're the people
because, in
power. Yes, we are in power, but as I've told you, it is basically our numerical strength. Tomorrow, if any other political party takes the biggest number of elective positions, and then they will be entitled to more money.
Yes.
So the funding we get from government is in the open, it's in the public domain. So I don't think of any, and we do not, the exactly what I was saying, that we do not have access to state coffers the way people have. We don't.
Mm-hmm.
I've never driven to the Bank of Uganda to pick money for anything. We always use what we have that comes from government and the other sources I've told you.
Absolutely.
Yes, other than that, really, I don't know about that. And
well, let me ask you something. Most other parties, these other parties, the opposition parties, are telling their members that if you do not have money, please don't waste your time.
Mm.
Don't waste your time coming as an aspirant. Don't come as you want to take part in the leadership of the party if you do not have money. How are you helping? Is the party, for example, supporting their own candidates? Do you like sponsor them, or do they have to sponsor themselves like it is happening? For example, in Noop, they were saying if you don't have money,
So I don't know why they would really limit people on that basis, because to us, we in some instances we fund our candidates. But on simple, for instance, now even when they express, there's expression of interest.
Of interest, yes.
But when they go through, because we've collected, much more people express interest, but now when we have flag bearers, we have a smaller number. So part of that money goes back to facilitate them with the nomination fee, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
But other than that, I think the opposition parties, if they are openly telling their members, that if you don't have money and then you shouldn't contest, that means they are actually, their intention is to bribe voters, which for us we do not encourage, and we can't tell our members that, because the only thing we can really support them with is nomination fee.
Absolutely.
Yes. So other than that, we expect Ugandans to elect their leaders based on issues, based on values that they see in them, not necessarily money. So it is, to me, absurd that a political party that thinks they are coming in to instill values, and yet they are the ones who want to promote bribery of voters by telling their members, don't come if you don't have money. For us, we don't have money to bribe voters, but it is the issues we stand on that attract people to us.
Well, from the onset, you said that at least the NRM, of course, has money from being, because of numerical strength and government as it comes in, but we see those cases around. I will not interrogate it further for reasons. The thing is, let's talk about the primaries for tomorrow.
Mm.
We are seeing violence. We are seeing the army and police being deployed, under the guise of security and all, but we also understand that with the presence of the military, presence of police, voters are somehow intimidated. Why is this happening within your own people? These are just the party primaries. What would this have an effect on the eventual elections in 2021?
In any election, all over the world, you've seen that there is no smooth election. But we've tried as much as possible to mitigate challenges. As many of you may have seen, the NRM leadership has been moving around the country, especially the Chairman Electoral Commission, moving to hotspots, trying to mitigate challenges ahead of tomorrow's elections. So really, we've tried to put measures in place to ensure that we have a smooth election. But also because we've also clearly mapped out hotspots, areas of Hoima, Sembabule, Koboko. Those hotspots, the Secretary General has officially written to the IGP based on a previous experience, but also based on what we have been seeing. We anticipate challenges in those given areas. So the presence of police or the enforcers of the law is really to give assurance to our people that they are secure, and their lives will be protected when they come to vote. So it is not really to intimidate anyone. It is to actually give confidence to the people to be able to turn up and vote. But also we are learning that a lot of the opposition political parties are actually the ones that are instigating and inciting violence.
But how? In your own primaries?
Yes, yes, they are doing that because one, they are interested in the outcome of the primaries. And of course, they're interested in the outcomes for obvious reasons that whoever finally contends with them must be someone weaker. And but I can assure them that whoever comes out of these primaries will be able to face them.
Do you have those results? Do you have actually evidence of that?
We have evidence in some instances, and I think it is with the relevant authorities. I'm not going to really dwell into that, but I can guarantee you that many of the violence, a lot of the violence, is from the opposition. They are the ones trying to incite, to make us appear
opposition in
bad
NRM.
In the political light. No, opposition.
Yes,
not in NRM. Not in NRM.
Yes, I understand.
Many of them from New, is it New? I don't know what they call it.
We understand outside forces.
Yes, outside our political. Many of our people have been peaceful. They've been in these elections before, and we always ensure that when one person wins, the others support. That's why we try as much as possible to harmonize them before this prime. Because at the end of the day, you've seen in some instances where 15 people are nominated for a political office, and one will go through eventually. So we
Absolutely.
Expect the 14 to support the other. So, but we are ready for whoever wants to cause violence at those scenes, because the forces will take over and ensure that lives and property is protected.
That's right. And yes. Also, the electoral commission chairperson said that if there's violence in your area, your election probably will be cancelled. So it will be rescheduled. Mm. Now, as we wind up, because, time is up. As we wind up, I wanted to know, what plans do you have for the party now that you're in this position? What plans do you have?
Of course, the most important thing is especially for elections, we have to field a candidate for every elective position.
Right.
We are not like these other political parties, they shout, but when it comes to fielding candidates from village to the highest level, they are nowhere to be seen. And you've seen that from the recently conducted SIG elections from village, and yesterday at parish level, that we are at over 80%, because we are able to ensure that we field candidates at all levels. That is very important. And we also want to be able, of course, the most important is to deliver our presidential candidate. And we are working within the law to ensure that we have him nominated. And finally, he will be able to face the opponents from the opposition political parties. But we are also doing a lot of mobilization activities, both resources and the mobilization for support.
Yeah.
Within this period, many of our activities are going to rotate around that.
Absolutely.
Yes. But eventually we will take over. And NRM, I can guarantee you, will still be the party in charge 2021.
Yes, so we only wait to see that on come 2021 and the eventual outcome. So thank you very much, Hajat Medina Naham, for joining us this morning and highlighting a few things that perhaps we didn't know. For example, we didn't know that there were outside forces, you know, creating havoc in the ongoing primaries, you know, so we didn't know that. Thank you very much for joining us. And thank you for watching. Those of you who are home, those of you who are going to work, please, we hope you have yourselves a lovely Thursday. Tomorrow is voting day, and we'll definitely be here to keep you updated on what's going on and how that is going to play out. A very good morning.